And sometimes we can feel so stressed out in our modern world that we think, oh, that would be great to just go live in a cabin out in the woods, minus the grizzly bears, of course. But we're actually made to be in community. And when you think about all the things that come together to make our world what it is, for us to be able to go down to the gas station and fill it up with gas. There was another more recent movie. Those of you who are adults might remember the Grizzly Adams thing, but the students can't. But a movie with Will that was called I Am Legend. And in I Am Legend, Will Smith was the only survivor of a zombie apocalypse type of thing. And he was in New York City and he could have anything he wanted. He could go to the store and get what he wanted. He could drive whatever car he wanted. And even that sometimes sounds good. But after a while, the gas is going to go bad. There's not going to be any electricity. The buildings are going to fall down. We're made to be in community with each other. And that's how our creative things and our ability to earn money and our ability to contribute to the world are improved when we're in community. So today we're going to be talking about dealing with people, and probably any of these topics could last the whole 90 minutes, but I'm just going to be touching on all of them just a little bit. The research will show, if you look it up, that married guys live longer than unmarried guys, and women live longer than men. Why is this? It's because women usually are better at forming a community around them and dealing with the people around them, where guys sometimes, not all guys, but some guys were too easy to become like Grizzly Adams and withdraw from our community. So let's start with dealing with parents. And I want to share this clip. This was from a favorite of my kids when they were growing up. That was one of my kids' favorite. I have four kids. They're all grown now, and they range in age from 33 to 23. And I have 8 grandkids. So I know all about kids and how they like to deal with parents. And because that movie was popular when my kids were around 5 to 8 to 10, somewhere around that age, they thought it was funny when mom and dad would tell them to do something and they would say, "Why should I?" And then when we got that raised eyebrow look on our face, then they would act like they were singing that song, "Why should I worry? Why should I?" And we were like, you're not going to do that. So the first rule with dealing with parents is be respectful. Even if you disagree with them, you can be respectful while disagreeing. This is something our culture has lost, even with adults who should know better. You can be respectful and totally disagree with somebody. Sometimes you have to look at things from a parent's perspective. A parent is looking at the whole household. You may have siblings. They may be trying to please their boss and try to please their spouse, and they're trying to pay the bills and they're trying to get everything done. And so their perspective is going to be different. For you, this one little thing is the most important thing for you right now, but something else might be weighing in on the parents. My mom right now is going into a nursing home. So the people that I'm interacting with at school, the students I have, even my coworkers, they don't necessarily know that I'm dealing with that. And that is something that for right now is weighing heavily on my mind. So that could be, your parents could have something that they're dealing with that is weighing heavily on their mind. So be respectful. Look at it from your parents' perspective. Number 3, realize that they are teaching you to be ready for life. They don't necessarily want you to be a good 14-year-old or a good 10-year-old or a good 11-year-old. They're looking at what type of person are you going to be when you are 21, when you are 30, when you're 50. And I've started, the older I get, the more long-term I look. As a 54-year-old now, I'm looking at decades and I'm looking at beyond my life even, of how I want my grandkids to be when I'm gone from this earth. So think about realize that they're teaching you to be ready for life. They're often having their own troubles or worries. And sometimes in a family situation, you need to compromise. Now that's sometimes it seems like a bad word. On some values, you never want to compromise. So when we see things like racism in our society and injustice, we never want to compromise on those things. But when we're talking about where are we going to eat or what time are we going to get the chores done or sharing a space with a sibling, those are things we can always be compromising to try to work together. I have 8 grandkids and they range in age from 9, and then there are 3 newborns that have just been born two newborns that have just been born in the last 2 months. And one of them comes from a family of 6 and one comes from a family of 2. And the research shows that people who come from large families are often better adapted to life. They get along better with their classmates. They get along better with their fellow employees. And the reason is because they've had to compromise a lot and make their life work out. So realize when you're in a family, if it's just 2 of you with 1 parent and you, or if there's 12 of you, it doesn't matter. You're still having to give and take and compromise and work together and think about what the other person's needs are. Rule number 4 when dealing with parents, be helpful without being asked. Be helpful without being asked. I think in some ways, this is almost like the most important rule. So many times, young people wait until their parents tell them to do something, and then their parents have to tell them again, and then their parents have to tell them again, and the parents get frustrated. But what if you did it without being told, without being asked, and you just said, "Hey, mom, I'm going to do the dishes because I know that's something that will clear something off your plate." And then you can sometimes talk to them about what some of your needs are. So suppose, I'm just going to lay out a scenario for you. Let's suppose the dishes are not getting done and you're not able to get your homework done because there's too many siblings around and they're making noise and you just can't seem to get away from them when you try to go to a quiet spot in the house. Younger siblings follow you there. But what if you said to your parents, "Hey, mom, I'm going to do the dishes. Do you mind if when I'm done with the dishes, if I just go off into my bedroom and could we maybe keep the younger siblings out of there? Because I need some quiet time or I need to get some homework done." I bet you 90% of the time, your parents would be willing to agree to that because you're doing something to help them. And then they're going to do something to help you. And this is how marriages work. This is how relationships work. The people who tell you that a marriage is 50-50, they're lying to you. Why? Because marriage is 100-100. Each of us, my wife and I, both give 100% to the other, and we look to what the other person's needs are. All right, so are there any questions about dealing with parents before we move on to dealing with teachers? All right, at any point, if you have some questions, put them in the chat and we'll be able to talk about those. So I've been a teacher for 23 years and I teach music. Before that, I was in the Army band and I've loved it. I've been in music for 34 years of all my adult life, really. I've been either a music performer or a music teacher, and I absolutely love it. And so some of these things that I'm going to share with you about dealing with teachers come from my experience of being a teacher. In fact, at one time, my second son, he's my third child, he was also my student at one point. He was at the high school that I taught at the time. And so we had worked out a whole way to deal with each other. He knew sometimes I was talking to him as dad, and sometimes I was talking to him as his band director. And we kind of knew when to do that. So just like with dealing with parents, be respectful. I'm going to give you a couple of scenarios here of things I've actually experienced from students. So scenario number 1, you tell a student some kind of rule or expectation that you have, and they're sitting there with a scowl on their face. And when you're done, or most of the time before you've been done, they say, "That's stupid." And what they're really saying is, I don't agree with something that you said, or it doesn't quite talk to me, but they didn't say it in the right way. And I've learned that as a teacher, I've learned that from experience. And I don't get angry at them anymore. But when I was a younger teacher, I did. All of a sudden, my defenses would go up to a 10. And now they go up a little bit. I can feel it a little bit. I'm like, oh, I'm going to talk to you later. And then I teach them about how to talk to their teachers. Because the best way to do that is, what if you're listening to something and you don't quite agree with it? Maybe something doesn't hit your ear right and it doesn't sound right to you. And you just raise your hand and you say, Mr., can I talk to you later about this? I have some questions. Or even to right then, if the teacher opens it up for questions, you can ask them some questions and be respectful about it. So there's a way to disagree with someone respectfully, and there's a way to that you're going to create tension and conflict between you and the teacher if you're not careful. Number two rule for dealing with teachers, plan ahead. Don't get behind. I can't tell you the number of students I've had who they start in August. And when I used to teach guitar, this happened more often in guitar class. And it would only be like 3 students out of 50. But they would come in, not do a thing. And I'd have to almost like force them just to get their guitar out. And then they'd hold the guitar. And then it's like, okay, push that down. And they didn't want to do anything. They didn't even want to try. And I called it the drooling look. They kind of got this kind of look on their face, like, and the drool's coming out and going down their the front of their shirt, because they're just like kind of looking off into space. But then like 3 days before the end of the semester in December, right? Now, mind you, this is August, September, October, November, December of doing nothing, not even trying, not even attempting anything. And 3 days before the grading period, Mr. Vine, what can I do to get an A in your class? It's kind of tough to get an A now. I don't even know if you can pass it at this point. But if they had planned ahead, and even some of the ones who kind of woke up from that maybe in October, and they're like, hey, I better get myself in gear and try to do something, at least they were able to like get their grade up to a C. So plan ahead. I remember in there was one point I used to teach fifth grade band. I started them in fourth grade, and by fifth grade, they were getting to where they were pretty decent. And we had this fun trip we always planned at the end of the school year, where we would go play at a retirement home. We would go to, if you're familiar with where Tinseltown is here, we would go to that area and have dinner somewhere there. And we would go see a movie, and they would get to pick the movie. And we usually had about 3 weeks, 4 weeks of planning time that we were planning for this. And they were always so excited to do this field trip. We did it in the evening. We would go right after school, let out, go eat and perform and see the movie. The one time one of the students said, Mr. Vine, we're going to have some homework. And it sounds like we're getting back pretty late. How are we going to do our homework? And I said, try this. You know, we've got 3 weeks before this performance. I said, go to your fifth grade teacher, ask her if you can get the homework in advance. Tell her we have this concert coming up in 3 weeks. We're getting home late. Could we get the homework in advance so we can get it done so that we can make sure that it's turned in? And I said, I bet you if you tell that to the fifth grade teacher that she's going to say, oh, don't worry about it. I'll make sure not to give you any homework that night. And they went and asked her if they could get the homework in advance. And that's exactly what she told them. And they thought I was magic. They're like, wow, how did you know she was going to say that? I just knew, because I knew that with their planning ahead, because most students would have come in the day after the performance and said, we didn't have time to do our homework because we were up late last night. Instead of pre-planning and trying to make sure they don't get behind. Tip number three when dealing with teachers, change your mindset. Sometimes I've had students who come in and maybe it wasn't their first choice of class, but they get put in my class and they sit there with their arms crossed and they're like, I hate this class. Well, it's kind of interesting because I teach music and most of the people who are in the class like the class, but there's a lot of people who hate math, who hate English, who hate social studies, but they've learned to accept those because they just have never had a choice sometimes in those things. Plus, I think if you change your mindset, change what's happening in here between your ears, then you can learn from any situation, even from something that you hate. I've learned how to be a good leader from watching good leaders and from watching bad leaders. I've learned how to be a good teacher by watching good teachers and watching and being in the class of bad teachers. I've learned something from everybody that has crossed my path, whether they were good people or bad people. Sometimes I learned how not to act. And so sometimes you can learn that way, because it doesn't matter if you like the teacher or not. When I was in high school, there was a teacher named Mr. Legan, and it seemed like he did not like students. He was the 12th grade government teacher, and there were like two or three government teachers, and everybody had to take government to pass. So you had about a 33% chance of getting Mr. Legan. But he would come into the junior class to welcome the juniors, but he would say, "Oh, I hope I get you, because I really love to fail people, and I'm going to make your life miserable if you get me for 12th grade." And nobody wanted to get his class. And I was fortunate. I got Mr. Trammell. Mr. Trammell was the kindest, nicest guy, and I learned a lot from him. But my sister, who was a year behind me, she got Mr. Legan. And my sister was a straight D student all the way through school. And so government in 12th grade was no exception for her. She had a straight D, and it all hinged on the final exam, the last week of May, whether she was going to graduate or not. So she went to, after she took her final exam, because if she passed the final exam, she would pass the class with a D. If she failed the final exam, she would fail the class and have to go to summer school. So she went right after she took the exam, and she went to Mr. Legan, and she said, "Did I pass?" And he said, "No, sucker, you didn't pass. Well, I guess we'll see you in summer school." He had no compassion or anything. My sister started bawling and crying. And she went home, and my mom said, "Don't worry, you know, you have plans to go to summer camp for a week, and then summer school starts after that. I'll go register you. It's 3 weeks long. You'll be done with it, and you'll get to graduate." Well, when my mom went to go register her, the office staff said, "We have her diploma here. Why didn't she show up at her graduation?" So I don't know if Mr. Legan did that on purpose. I really hope he didn't, but he just was always kind of approaching students in a mean way. But I learned from him, watching him interact with students. It's like, I'm never going to interact with students in that way. You can sometimes talk to a trusted adult. Sometimes there's a conflict, for example, if you're in sports. And I taught band at high school, and there were oftentimes conflicts between a game and a concert. And I always told the students, let the adults figure that out. And I'll tell you the true story of what happened, because coaches are great. I've learned a lot from coaches, but sometimes they're so focused on their sport. They love their sport, whether it's soccer or basketball, that they think everybody loves it the same as them and has the same commitment to them. So the coach would like tell one of my band students who came to, let's say, basketball. The coach would say, "If you miss a single practice, you are off the team. No excuses for whatever. Unless your mom is sick or in the hospital, you will not miss a practice." So the students would come to me and they would say, "Mr. Devine, I can't make it to our concert." And I always asked why, because early when I was younger, I would get mad. But, you know, I don't know what the reason is. They could be saying, "I'm going to miss the concert because my mom is sick." Well, that's going to take priority over any concert. But when they would tell me it was just a practice, I would say, no, let me talk to the coach. And that way the students didn't have to deal with it. So get the adults in your life talking together so that they resolve it. If you have two adults in your life and one saying you have to do this and the other one says you have to do this, and it's like opposite things, then you need to get those two people together and say, "Okay, coach, teacher, parent, I have this conflict and I'm not sure which one I'm supposed to do," and let them be the ones to figure it out. Number four, when dealing with teachers, listen as much as you talk. I had a student one time who came to me after class and she said, "Mr. Devine, my grade is lower than I want in your class. Can you tell me how to get my grade up?" And as soon as I tried to tell them, then they said, "Hold on a second." And then typed in a text. Mr. Devine, can you tell me how to get my grade up? Wait a second, Mr. Devine. And finally, after like three times of them going to answer a text, I said, when you really are ready to care about your grade, then come back and talk to me. And they tried to put it away. No, I'll talk to you now. I said, no, come back tomorrow and we can talk and be ready to be focused on what we're doing now instead of being distracted. I had another student who said to me something like, Mr. Devine, they had sent me an email. And I said, this is something that's better if we talk to face-to-face. So talk to me in class tomorrow and we can talk about this more in depth. And they kept avoiding it. They just sent me an email and with the same question. And I just kept saying, no, talk to me face-to-face. We need to talk about this. It's hard to explain in an email. And then they said, I don't feel comfortable talking face-to-face. Nobody does at first. Anything you haven't done much of, you're going to feel uncomfortable doing. When I first started presenting on a computer, I didn't feel comfortable doing that because I love seeing people's faces and seeing their eyes, but I got better the more that I did it. So it's the same thing with talking to adults in your life. The more you do it, the better you'll get at it and the more comfortable you will get. So don't use that uncomfortable thing as an excuse. If there's any questions, I'll take those before showing you a clip about a student who approached things the most perfect way possible. Are there any questions?
No questions in the chat right now, but if anybody has any question, you can either unmute yourself or put it in the chat.
All right, here's a clip about a fifth grade student who knew how to deal with her teachers. It was about 20 years ago, and I was brand new at teaching middle school. I was in about my third year or so of teaching, and I took my students to the Adams State University Jazz Festival, about a 2.5 hour, 3 hour drive from Colorado Springs, where I live. I was so excited about this day because there were so many fun things for the students to do. Besides our performance, we had performances to watch, we had clinics, we had so many different things to do. And it felt like I was getting complaints throughout the day. Students saying, I'm tired, I want to go home. Well, I was a new teacher, so I didn't know yet that I should have planned some extra time in there for everyone to have some rest. But I wasn't going to listen to whininess and complaining until Katie came and sat down next to me. Now, Katie was smart. She sat down next to me and she said, Mr. Devine, this has been a really fun day and we really appreciate all the activities that you've brought us and that you want us to do. But some of us are really tired and we just wondered if we could possibly go home a little bit early. And once I heard it from her asking in that way, then we ended up scooting out after the concert that we were watching about 3 hours earlier than I had planned. And it was good because we still got back about 9 p.m. and we were all very tired. So when you speak to your parents, when you speak to your teacher, think about how you approach it. Because if you approach it all grumpy, I'm tired, I'm sick of this, get out of my room, then probably nothing's going to change. But if you think about how Katie approached it and you talk to your parents and teachers that way, then you might see some change. Have an awesome day. Katie was pretty amazing for a seventh grade girl. Hold on a second, I'm figuring out the technology. Okay, thank you. She was pretty awesome for a seventh grade girl. And that's, whenever you start whining, it puts up like a wall between you and whoever you're talking to. So we don't ever want to see that kind of whining. All right, now this next one is one of the hard ones, dealing with friends and peers. Research shows that you are most likely to become like the five people you hang out with the most. So if they are getting good grades, you're more likely to get good grades. If they're obeying their parents, you're more likely to obey your parents. And this is why parents know this, because they've seen it in their own lives. And this is why parents always are worried about what kind of friends you have and who you're hanging out with, because it's the rare person who can hang out with someone who, a group of people who are pulling them down and not follow them down that path. This next clip talks about how to choose friends wisely.
Hey, yo, real quick, I want to talk to you guys about something. Who are you hanging out with? You know, there was a 20-year study done at Harvard. It said that your physical health is determined more by your relationships than the food you eat, the exercise program you're on, or the genes that you have inherited. Who are you hanging out with? Do they make you feel good and motivated, or drained and maybe a little sick? Listen, if you want to catch the flu, what do? You hang out with somebody with the flu. Well, if you want to catch a happy, optimistic attitude about life, then you got to hang around people with happy, optimistic attitudes about life so you can catch it. Who are you hanging out with? Who are your best friends? You want to know the definition of a best friend? It should be someone who brings the best out of you. Not someone you got to act a certain way around to be cool. You know, there's an old saying, birds of a feather flock together. And you know what type of birds flock? Pigeons do. Eagles don't flock. So are you a pigeon or are you an eagle? Do you want to flock or do you want to soar high into the skies? Well, if you want to soar, then you might have to step away from where you are so that you can become who you were meant to be. Peace.
So who we hang out with, who is a true friend? That is one of the most important things of realizing who a true friend really is, because a lot of young people, they have this false idea of what a friend is, and they have this false loyalty that it's normal. I was like that the same way your parents were like that also, but it's not the best thing for life. And we'll talk about that a little bit, but I want to share another clip with you. Who is a true friend in your life? I can probably count on one or two hands the number of friends I have that are really true friends. And how do you know who those people are? Some people say if you can just have one or two really true friends, then your life is extra rich. A true friend is the one who's going to come and visit you in jail, even if you were guilty of the crime. There's not very many people like that. A true friend will wound you to save you from something worse. And a true friend is willing to tell you the truth, even if it means that they lose their friendship with you. And I've lost a couple of friendships when I've had to tell someone the truth. So be a true friend to somebody and think about who your true friends are. They're not necessarily the people on your social media who like you. Have a great day. A true friend. If you can just have three of those in your life, you are doing really well. I had a friend named Troy one time. There were three or four of us guys who hung out together, and we did a weekly bike ride, and then we would go eat at Chipotle. You can't go wrong with that, bike riding in Chipotle. Well, we had to challenge this friend Troy because he wasn't treating his wife very nice. Now, I don't mean like he was abusing her physically or anything like that, but he just was not very nice to her. And we called him on it and we said, you've got to stop. You're not treating your wife right. And instead of listening, he just like broke off the friendship. And that's been over 20 years ago. So a true friend cares enough about you that they'll tell you true things, even if it means losing the friendship. I had a student once who I had her from eighth grade through 12th grade. I used to teach at a K through 12 private school. And I had her 8th through 12th. And she quit band the last 3 weeks of her senior year because she was extremely grouchy. And we just were having conflicts every day. And I think the school just said, instead of dealing with this conflict, we're just going to let her drop your class. And it was really sad because I thought, that's really sad that we ended in that way after having 5 years of a great relationship and then 3 weeks where Things weren't that great. But when she got into her 30s, she reached out to me and we became social media friends. And it was interesting to see how much she had grown in that time. So she just had a grouchy period in her life. And like I was telling you earlier, as a teacher, I want to help people to become their best person for when they're 30, not necessarily when they're 14 or 17 or 18. I'm thinking about when they're in their 30s, 40s, and 50s, helping them to become a great person. A true friend will avoid the drama surrounding our lives. I teach at a middle school, and so we have a lot of drama that happens there. And most of the time, the drama that's happening, it's not people who are really, truly friends with each other. They think they are, they call them their friend, but the way they treat each other, it's like, I don't even treat my enemies like that. My enemies, I just avoid. But they think that these people are their friends, but their friends are spreading rumors about them and creating all kinds of conflict and different things. So remember that the real friends, if you can have three of those in your life, I'm fortunate. I feel like I have 5 to 7 at this point in my life, but I didn't always have that, versus the fake friends. And when I say fake friends, it's not anything wrong with that. But like on Facebook, they're called your friends. But really, most of those people are acquaintances. And there's nothing wrong with that. We all have acquaintances. At my work, there's about 40 teachers who work there. I would call one or two of them friends. And then most of them are just acquaintances. And some I don't really ever talk with except to say hello to them in the hallway. And all of that's okay. But I can't call all those acquaintances my friends. They're not my true friends. All right. So that was number one with dealing with friends, peers. Who is a true friend? Number two, it's about them, not about you. A lot of times you see this, especially in dating type of relationships, and people say, oh, they make me feel so good. I feel so good when I'm around them. And I was young and felt that way one time, but then I realized that true love is not about me. It's about the other person. So it's about my wife. It's about my friend. It's about my kids. It's not how they make me feel or whether they make me happy or joyful. It's about what is best for them. And that's what really unconditional love is about them. And sometimes you'll see this in a lot of graduation speeches. So when you get to the point where you're graduating, you might hear this in a speech because it seems to be in about 1/3 of the graduation speeches. And someone who's famous or has endured a lot, they'll stand up there and they'll say, follow your heart. Now, we've been given our heart, our emotions. That's what they mean when they say that, is your emotions. We've been given our emotions, and they're an important part of who we are. But if we follow that, we're going to get in lots of trouble, because sometimes our heart tells us that we're angry and we just want to run away from a situation, and that's not the best thing to do. So our heart and our mind have to be connected, and that same thing happens in friendships. Don't just follow your heart, follow your mind too, and think about what the consequences of those emotions are. Emotions are good, but we have to realize that they're just emotions and not what's going to change the world. All right, number three, let's talk a little bit about peer pressure. Now, peer pressure can be bad, of course, but peer pressure can be good. You might say, what? Peer pressure can be good. What are you talking about? Well, if you're in we talked about that circle of like 5 people and you become like them. If you're in a group of people who are getting good grades and they're putting pressure on you to get good grades, if they're putting pressure on you to do what your parents are telling you that you should do, then that's going to be positive peer pressure. So it can be positive or negative. And we have to take control of that in our lives. I didn't always choose wisely. I'm just going to tell you that now. I didn't always choose wisely. I was the product of a single mom, and I didn't have the influence of a dad in my life. And there were times, especially around middle school age, that I was getting in trouble a little bit. In 7th grade, I'm going to give you some advice for some ways you can deal with negative peer pressure. In 7th grade, the kids I was hanging around with, they were starting to get into marijuana. And they would hold these parties, and someone would say, oh, my parents are going to be gone this weekend, or they're going to be gone all day Saturday. We're going to meet at such and such house. And they started inviting me to come to these things. And I knew I'd seen so many people go down that path and ruin their lives. And I knew I didn't want to do that, but I wasn't brave enough to tell them, no, I don't want to do that. So I ended up putting the blame on my mom. And I would say, well, let me check with my mom. I need to check with her and see if she'll let me go. And I would never ask my mom, but I would tell them the next day. I would say, I'm sorry, I can't be there on Saturday because my mom said no. And they never questioned that. So I put the blame of avoiding the bad situations on my mom. Now in 10th grade, one of the things that I had a big regret about was that I actually rode with somebody who was drunk. I didn't know they were drunk at first. I was getting a ride home from them from a football game. And I realized in a very short amount of time, and I wish, and I'm telling you what you should do now. I wish I would have told that young man to pull the car over and let me out. And then I could have walked. We didn't have cell phones at the time. I would have had to walk to a payphone and call home. But I wish I would have done that, because so many things could have gone wrong in that situation. So if you find yourself in a situation you never meant to be in, then get out of it as fast as you can, because it's going to really help you. For me, one of the things that saved me during that difficult time when I was almost starting to go on the wrong path was that I went to church regularly, and I had a lot of friends there. So there was that five people. I had more like 10 who surrounded me and who lifted me up and encouraged me to do the right thing. And that was my peer group. And then the bad peer group was like at school. So I think that really helped me a lot through that time in my life. Number four, when dealing with friends, what if a friend says that they're going to harm themselves? Maybe they're having suicidal thoughts. This is where that false loyalty comes in that I was talking about, that teens sometimes have. Well, I promised him I wouldn't tell anybody. Think about if you use this as your guide, what is best for that person? Not what you promised them, because it's not fair to hold you to a promise like that. When you find out something like that, if it's something where they're like, I'm mad at my mom, don't tell my mom because I know I'll get over it, but I'm just mad at her. That's different, keeping that kind of promise. But if someone's going to do something that's harmful to them, if they're going to run away, if they're having suicidal thoughts, you need to do what's best for them. And that's going to be getting an adult to help you. Tell your parents, tell your priest or pastor, tell your counselor at school, tell a trusted teacher, tell somebody about that. Promising not to tell, that is false loyalty. Oh, that's not the one I wanted. Sorry, I was at the wrong one. All right, so now let's talk about dating a little bit. I'm just going to tell you my opinion on this. I think at your age, you need to just really be friends with a lot of people, because I'm going to be honest with you. When you hold hands, when you kiss, when you hug, all those things release endorphins into your body, which is kind of the feel-good chemical. And those are all good things for some point in your life. But what they do when you're young is they cloud your judgment. And you might not realize this person is a terrible person for me. Sometimes your friends can all see it. But if you're getting too close to somebody at a young age, then those endorphins will cloud your judgment. They kind of put a film over your judgment part of your brain. And I made many mistakes with this. I had so much low self-esteem. I always felt like I had to have a girlfriend. And finally, when I was in 11th grade, a good friend of mine from church, her name was Amy. She said, James, why do you always feel like you have to have a girlfriend? And I don't even think she realizes what an impact that made on me, because after 11th grade, I don't know if she moved or maybe because I started dating my wife soon after that, but we kind of lost touch. And those words have impacted me my entire life from that. So I, from going from her words, I decided, you know what? I'm going to stop this dating stuff. I'm just going to become friends with people. And you know what? That's when I found my wife. And so I was 17, almost 18 when she and I started getting to know each other. And we were dating for 2.5 years. And we ended up getting married after that. And we've been married now for 34 years. Your parents know you very well. So I would, and they've had their own experiences. So you need to follow their advice. If your parents say you need to wait till you're 16 to date, or if they say you need to wait till you're 18, or if they say you need to wait till you're 30, I'm just kidding about the 30 part, but follow the advice that your parents have for you on that, because they know you well. And the other thing is, don't make it a secret. When you start keeping secrets from your parents, that's when they get worried. And my youngest son, I really have to give him praise in this, because some of the girls that he was seeing, I didn't really approve of, but he always would bring them to meet me. And he'd say, Dad, I want you to meet this girl. She's my new friend. And he always was so proud to introduce us. And so he never was trying to keep anything a secret. And I really, even now, he's the one who's 23. Even now I tell him that I really appreciate that about him. But there's a secret to a successful marriage. I'm half Italian, and this is a little known secret about how to have a successful marriage. So I hope you enjoy this Italian secret to a successful marriage. Did you know there's a little known Italian secret that can predict if your marriage is going to be successful? Yes. And it comes from my little 5-foot-tall Italian mom. And I'm going to share that with you in a minute. But first, a shout out to my wife of 34 years. She's my best friend. We've shared life together for 34 years, raised 4 kids, and now we have 8 grandkids. When people ask me how long we've been married, I tell them, not long enough. Something that good Italian boys do, which I am one of those good Italian boys, is they bring their girlfriends home to meet mama, to get mama's approval. And I was always so excited. All these girls that I was dating through high school, it seemed like I always had a girlfriend. I didn't have much self-esteem back in those days. And I always felt like I had to have a girlfriend. And I'd be like, she's the one. She makes my heart beat so fast. And I would bring her home to meet my mom. And then after dinner, it's like, mom, what do you think about this one? What do you think about this one?
Jimmy, she's not the one for you.
Time after time, my mama answered me,
Jimmy, she's not the one for you.
Jimmy, she's not the one for you. Jimmy, she's not the one for you.
I decided no matter who I brought home, she's not going to like anybody, and I'm just going to have to live a single celibate life. When I brought Susan home for the first time, I expected the same answer from my mom, but this time the answer was different.
Jimmy, she's the one for you, I know.
So I said, Mom, how is this one any different? You've always told me the same thing. She's not the one for you. She's not the one for you. And now you're telling me that this is the one. How can you know? You just met her.
Jimmy, I know she's the one for you because when we have a dinner, she asks for seconds.
So now you know the secret Italian predictor of a successful marriage is lasagna. Could you see the resemblance that my mom and I had to each other in that clip? But she really did say that. She kept saying that that was not the right one for me. Do we have any questions so far? All right, so let's go on. We're going to talk about some other things about like how to relate to other people. So this next one is going to be how to apologize. There was another show I like to watch. Like I said, I watched way too much TV when I was in junior high. was one called Happy Days. And there was a character on there named the Fonz, and he was so cool, but there was something he had a hard time with.
Ralph, I was not exactly right.
What do you mean not right?
I mean not right.
I don't get you.
You mean you were wrong?
Mm.
Yeah, that's right, Malfoy. I was what you just said I was just.
The Fonz did not like to apologize. He had a really hard time with it. And growing up, I had a stepfather. He passed away at a young age. He was in his late 40s when he passed away. But he had a hard time saying he was sorry. He didn't like doing that. And this is one of the things that's going to help you in your relationships with people. You have to learn how to be able to say you're sorry and how to apologize. So I want to give you a clip that shows you the proper way to apologize. And I'm going to leave this one on the not full screen because I think there's some words that go with it at the bottom. I don't think it's going to work that way. I'm sorry, but.
Sorry.
Now, let's talk about a proper apology. When you tell someone that you're sorry, you need to include what you're sorry for. I'm sorry for punching you in the nose. I'm sorry for stealing your dollar. I'm sorry for speaking to you rudely. Make sure you include what you're sorry for. Make eye contact the entire time. It can feel uncomfortable, but sometimes the best things in life that we do are going to feel uncomfortable. Then you want to talk about what you're going to do in the future. In the future, I'm going to watch my words. In the future, I'm going to count to 10 before I react to my brother. Something like that. Or if you did something that caused harm, if you broke something or you stole something, you're going to have to think about what the restitution is. So instead of in the future, you might say, since I made a mess in my room, I'm going to clean the entire house for you. Or since I made a hole in the yard, because I wasn't thinking about what I was doing, I'm going to help landscape the rest of the yard. Think about some way to either in the future what you're going to do with your actions or to make restitution for something that you've done. Then you want to end it with, will you forgive me? So how to apologize. And there's a companion video to that. I'm not going to show you that right now, but there's the one for how to accept an apology, because sometimes people don't accept one very gracefully and they're thinking, well, I'm not going to forgive them. But we all do things that sometimes put a strain on one of our relationships. That can happen in a marriage, parent to child, student to teacher, teacher to teacher, all friends, all those things have things that require an apology. Then we have to, this goes a little bit deeper, and I'm not going to get into it this a lot, but sometimes we have things that have happened to us that we need to forgive and let go of. I had a period of time when I was younger that I went through some abuse, and I had to learn how to forgive that because it was putting a weight on me and holding me back from becoming the person that I was meant to be. And when I was able to forgive and move on from that, then I was able to achieve much greater things. My father-in-law, he looks at his stepdad as his dad. His dad just passed away. He was about 90 years old. But his mom married his stepdad when my father-in-law was about 10 years old. And he had to deal with his father leaving, because his father left about a year or two before that and never told him why he was leaving. He was close to his dad. So that was painful for him. And he had to learn how to forgive that and move on from that. All right, let's talk about now how to deal with rude people. We all come across people who sometimes are rude or grouchy. And I'm going to tell you something. You might be surprised at some of the ways that we need to deal with them. You have to excuse my grandfather clock that was just chiming over there. Think about this. Are you ever grouchy? Yes. Are you ever grouchy? I know I am. I have times when I'm grouchy. If I miss a meal, I start getting grouchy. Or if I don't have enough sleep, I start getting grouchy. The older I've gotten, the more I've learned to recognize when those things are happening. But we all have times when we're grouchy. Nobody's exempt from that. I haven't met anybody who's not grouchy, at least some of the time. It doesn't mean that you lose total control over that. You can have some control over that. So I heard a story once of this guy who was on a bus. And there was a lady on the bus, and she had like 3 kids. And the kids were just running all over the place and bothering other people on the bus and just causing havoc on the bus. And finally, the guy couldn't take it anymore. And he said something. He's like, "Miss, could you please control your children? They're getting into everything." And she kind of looked like she snapped out of a daze. And she said, "I'm so sorry. My husband just passed away. And I can't even think to get through life." So this guy, who was the one telling the story, he said he felt so bad because he didn't know that she was going through something. He was just starting to judge her for not controlling her kids, but their dad had just died and she had just lost her husband. I've learned something. This has been very effective for me. It's not 100%, but nothing is. Sometimes when I encounter someone who seems kind of grouchy, I could throw it back at them and I could say, "You're grouchy," but that doesn't accomplish anything. That just puts that puts that fence up, that wall that we talked about, just like when you answer a teacher or a parent in the wrong way. But I found when I use this statement, "You seem like you're having a bad day," sometimes they've broken down in tears. Because they are. That's usually why they're grouchy. Something's going on in their life, but they're still having to go to work. They're still having to present a positive image to everybody. So try that. Like I said, it's not 100%, but say it with compassion and kindness in your voice. If someone's treating you grouchily, and just say, "You seem like you're having a bad day," and see what they say. They probably will open up to you. And something I started doing too, I don't do this all the time, and if you're a teen, you may not have the money to do this, but you would be amazed at how much it brightens someone's day. If you are going through a checkout line and you're buying some cookies or flowers or something like that, try this. Try it once a month if you can afford to do it. Buy an extra candy bar and give it to the cashier. And just say, "Hey, I know you're on your feet all day. This is really hard." It's really about empathy, looking at what other people are going through, just like we talked about earlier with parents, seeing it from their point of view, and trying to have some empathy and compassion for them. Sometimes people who seem like they're grouchy aren't always grouchy. And I'll give you the example. The first place I taught at was a private school, and the maintenance people at the school, they would, if you asked them a question about something, they always seemed like they were grouchy. Well, they just weren't really people I'm not sure if I'm saying that right. They were great at working on the air conditioning system, the engine of the buses on campus, but they didn't always like interacting with people. So if you asked them a question, they weren't good at explaining it to you. So they would seem like they were grouchy, but they were some of the nicest people I knew. They just weren't good at explaining things. So sometimes we interpret things as being grouchy when it's really just someone's personality. So I want you to assume the best. When you're dealing with someone, always assume the best. Unfortunately, my mom doesn't always assume the best about people's intentions. And this is a story from something that happened with my mom. I once got off of work and I found that I had 3 voicemails from my mom in a short period of time. And so I was worried about her. I was like, something has happened. Maybe some emergency has happened. And so I checked my voicemails. Voicemail number 1.
Jimmy, this is your mom. Please give me a call. In the case you not remember, this is your mom.
She always felt like she had to remind me that she was my mom, but with that accent, who could ever forget that, right? So on to voicemail number 2. Voicemail number 2 became a little bit more sarcastic.
Jimmy, in the case you don't know, this is your mom. Did you forget my number? Here it is again, 8675309.
Okay. Let's see what's on the 3rd voicemail, and then I'll call her back and see what she needed to know. I checked the 3rd voicemail, and she was extremely upset in this one.
Jimmy, if you don't want to talk to me, just tell me. Don't ignore my phone calls.
I called her up. I said, Mom, I was at work. I got all 3 of your voicemails.
Oh, I'm sorry, Jimmy. I didn't know you was at work. I thought you don't want to talk to me.
My mom, unfortunately, had this lifetime thing of assuming the worst about what people were thinking or doing, or assuming that they were doing something on purpose to annoy her. And it was something I had to unlearn because I went through a phase of doing that also. So when someone treats you in a certain way or says something, or even if they just seem like they have forgotten to say hello to you, maybe you're passing in the hallway, assume the best. Don't assume the worst. Assume that maybe they're going through something. Maybe they don't have a chance to return your phone call. Have a wonderful day and be blessed and assume the best. Assume the best about every interaction you have with people. If they're not returning your text, maybe they have something going on. Maybe they lost their phone because they were not doing what they were supposed to with their parents. So assume the best. And you can even be the one to reach out again. Hey, I sent you a text a day ago and I haven't heard back from you. Is everything okay? Assume that maybe something happened and they can, maybe they're just busy. So assume the best. If you don't know the description of cancer is a horrible thing, and it's when a group of cells in the body goes haywire and they start taking over and multiplying in ways they weren't meant to do. And so it's always a good thing. I mean, it's always a bad thing for the body, and it takes over the good things that your body is supposed to be doing. And this is what gossip is like. Gossip is a horrible verbal cancer that will eat away at relationships, and it'll eat away at people's self-esteem. And at all costs, avoid gossip. And if you're not sure what gossip is when you're talking about somebody, something that you don't know if it's true, and you're talking about it behind their back. The best thing to do, we'll talk about the best way to deal with things in a moment, but avoid gossip.
Today, I want to talk about something that's a poison in so many people's lives, and that poison is gossip. You need to beware of gossip. Gossip is like a cancer. It can end up going throughout your entire organization and killing any joy, any creativity, any lifeblood in the relationships. And gossip is a big danger. Whenever someone says that they don't gossip, that's when you know that they probably are. Or when they preface something, hey, I'm not gossiping or anything, but did you hear? They're probably gossiping. And maybe like me, you've been guilty by association. I know I've been guilty so many times where I didn't want to be rude to the person who was being rude. And so I listened to them gossiping. Don't do it. Stop it right before it starts and expose it for what it is. Hey, I don't want to hear that. You're gossiping. No, I'm not gossiping. Oh, yes, you are. You're gossiping. If you do that, then it's going to help that person become a much better person. I want to tell you something that I learned the hard way over the experience of a lifetime, of a half century. I know I don't look it or anything, but I am 51 years old. And what I learned during that time is that that person who's gossiping about another person with you, when you're not around, they're gossiping about you. So nip it in the bud. The tongue is such a small part of our body. It's so small, but it has the potential to do so much damage. It also has the potential to do a lot of good. Use it for good. Here in Colorado, we have the danger of wildfires every summer. And this summer is going to be particularly bad because we've had such a dry winter. We've already had 3 or 4 fires in my local area here just in the month of March. And it's not even high time season yet, which is like July. Usually the fires don't come early. You take that small spark from a campfire, from a misplaced cigarette, whatever it might be, and that small spark can burn miles and miles of land and do so much damage. But I don't want to focus on the damage. That small spark is also what lights your water heater, what lights your electric stove, what lights your gas forced air heat. So it has the potential to do good things when it's under control. It's when it gets out of control. So I want to challenge you, use your tongue to lift people up. Use your tongue to encourage people. And if you can't say anything nice, then follow the advice that most of us got from our parents. If you can't say something nice about something, don't say anything at all. I hope to see you back next week. Have a very blessed week.
All right, so I don't want anyone to be worried about fires happening. That was from 3 years ago when we had a summer where there was a lot more fire. So you might say, well, how do you deal with it then? If you have a problem with someone, if you go and you talk behind their back, that's gossiping. That's not good. Here's what you do. First, you go one-on-one and you talk with that person. If you have a problem with them, you talk to them. If you're not getting any satisfaction, then you bring one or two others with you, trusted adults or another friend. And you, just like I did with that friend I was telling you about who wasn't treating his wife right. First, it was just me and him. We talked about it. He wasn't listening. I brought our other friends into it in front of him, not behind his back. I didn't go talk to those friends behind his back. It was like two other friends and me and this guy who wasn't treating his wife right. And then if they're not listening, then sometimes it can be sometimes time to terminate the friendship or put them out of the circle of what you're in. And that's what we had to do with that friend because he decided he wasn't going to change and we did not like the way that he was treating his wife. So first you go to the person one-on-one, then you bring a few others with you who are part of that group. And then you kind of like get rid of that relationship. All right, we're going to do a couple of rapid fire things about how to communicate, the best way to communicate. So when you're talking on the phone, this is hard for teens today. In my age, everybody was on the phone. That was the main way that you communicated. So we kind of had to learn how to do that. And we didn't have our own phone. So you had a shared phone. And I think finally, when I was an adult is when the cordless phones came around, so you weren't tied to the wall. You there used to be a long cord and you could buy longer cords. So sometimes you could go around a corner and have a little bit of privacy. And then we had the cordless phones. So think of that as like a cell phone, but the range of it was just within the house. When you're on the phone, you want to make sure that you say who you are, that you say what you're calling about, and that you're very respectful and you speak clearly into the phone. Because the person not everybody has caller ID, or they may not know that it's you, or sometimes if you're a teen, it may show up with your parents' name. If it's someone you call a lot, if you have friends you call all the time, then you're going to know that you might do that differently and not have to be so formal with it. But if it's someone you're calling, you want to make sure that you say who you are and who you're calling for when you do that. Email and text. Now, I know teens mostly text, but especially with the pandemic, with a lot of schools going with online learning, a lot of students have done a lot with emails, especially to communicate with their teachers. You want to make sure that you write in an email or a text, especially an email, write it just like you would if you're writing a paper for school. I've had so many emails I've gotten from students, and I had no idea what they were asking me because they just like put three short words and I don't even know what they're talking about. And it's the 50th email I've gotten from a student that day. So I can't remember previous conversations I've had with them or anything like that. So put what you're talking about, who you are. If it's not clear from the email, most school emails, it's pretty clear because it's usually your first name and last name. But if you just have a GameBoyAddict@yahoo.com, no one except your friends knows who that is. So then if you're using that as your email, then you need to say, hey, Mr. Smith, this is Brian from school, and I just had a question about my English assignment, or whatever the case might be. Now, here's the warning I have for you. Email and text should never have bad news. You should never use those as a way to share bad news. That's when you either want to be in person or on the phone, or maybe even on a Zoom call where you can see the person. 73 to 75% of communication is nonverbal. It's what you see with the person's expressions, their gestures, their eyes, their tone of voice. And you don't always get that in an email. So like earlier in my teaching career, sometimes I would send parents emails with their students having gotten a bad grade, and they didn't always have a good reception to that because they couldn't read the care and compassion in my voice when it was an email. In an email, all they read is the bad news about their child having a bad grade. But when I'm talking to them on the phone, I can say, hey, Mrs. Jones, this is Brian's teacher, and he's got a bad grade in my class right now, but I really want to help him to get that grade up. Then they can hear that compassion in my voice. So never use email or text for bad news, only for good news or information that you're trying to pass along. All right, so I've got one more video for you, how to write a thank you note. I met a man who was head of the Colorado Department of Deaf Education or something like that, and he was mostly deaf. He came and spoke at the school I used to teach at. And he talked a little bit about his work, but he immediately got my admiration because as an executive, he wrote three thank you notes a day. And thank you notes are great because if you do them, you're going to make yourself more elevate yourself in the eyes of other people because very few people do it anymore. So, and in this video, it's going to tell you when you should give a thank you note. Everyone is gifted in art, so we're going on a field trip.
now we arrive at my favorite store ever. I guarantee you that if you get in the habit, if you get in the habit of writing thank you notes, then you're going to be in the top 1% of people all over Colorado Springs. Do we have any questions about tonight's presentation? All right, I have really enjoyed being here with you tonight. I hope that you've learned something that you can take with you. If you want to go and get the videos or take a look at them again or see some other clips, then you can find that at jamesdevine.net/people, and that will give you some other some access to the videos that we saw tonight, so you can watch them again or show them to another student. Thank you so much for having me here tonight.
Thank you, James, so much. If everyone could use your reactions and give James a round of applause. This is a great presentation, lots of fun videos, and hopefully everybody learned a little something. And if you had your students watching with you, hopefully they picked up some great tips and great presentation. Super excited, loved it. So parents, thank you all for being here tonight. Our gift card winners for tonight are Amy Hughes, Monica Skelton, and Pamela Stein. Those will be Amazon gift cards. I will send those out to you later on. And yeah, parents, thank you guys so much for continuing to be with Parents Challenge. And thank you again, James, for being here tonight. So we hope you all have a great night. And we will see you next time.